Hey, before we get into God's word, I just want to say something. I have the worst memory ever, so I hope that you guys listen to what we share from God's word from the pulpit every week, because I usually forget, but hopefully it's doing something here. But I know there was a last week or the week before, I don't remember what it was, but I shared about the importance of coming to church and that Jesus went to church every single day. You know, I think it was Luke 21:35 or something. I don't know. It was in there. And I talked about Hebrews 10:25, where it says, don't neglect the gathering together as some people do. Like, Christians should go to church, right? You know what I'm talking about? I just want to direct your attention to my left. I want to just, can you guys see? That's Pops, right? Pops. Pops just had quadruple bypass surgery a couple weeks ago, right? And he's got a walker, and he's got oxygen, and he's been gutted from here to here and ripped veins out of his legs, and he's here tonight. So that's what not neglect the gathering together looks like. You know what I'm saying? When it's important to you, you make it, right? Hell or high water, I'm getting to church, right? You know what I'm saying? So next time you feel like blowing it off for a baseball game, think of old Pops over there, okay? He's here. I just want to personally say hello to Hannah. Is Troy home too? Is Troy? He's at work. Good man. Good man. He's at work, right? What he is. So hello, everyone there in Facebook Live world. It's good to kind of see you. You can see us. I know you're in there. So welcome. So anyway, okay. So we've been studying through the Gospel of Luke, and we're trying to we're ramping up on truth so we could amp up on spirit. That's the whole purpose of that, right? We're supposed to gather some truth about who Jesus Christ is. And when that truth hits your heart and your head, you can't help but get fired up about who Jesus is, right? So the reason why you see someone like David dancing before the Lord naked, right, and unashamed is because he didn't care what anyone else thought. He understood how awesome God was, and so he was just dancing, right, because he knew the truth about who God was, and so he was unashamed, and so that's what we're looking for, because Jesus wants to build his church. He wants to be famous. Okay, now, let me just tell you something, just in case you don't know. People talk about the church is not about numbers. Jesus Christ, being the one true God, deserves to be worshipped by everyone on earth. That's 7 billion people. That's a big number. He wants every one of us to worship him because he's worthy of being worshiped, right? So he wants to build his church because the Bible says that a king's glory is a growing population. The more people worshiping him, the better, right? That's a good amen spot. Hold on a second. Let me back it up a little, give you another chance. The more people that worship him, the better. Amen, right? That's what we're looking for. And he wants to build his church, and he's partnering with us, and we're partnering with him to build his church. How do we do that? We do that by preaching Jesus. The more you know, the more amped up you'll be, and the more people will walk in and go, whoa, what's up? And they want to be a part of something fantastic. And so we've been preaching through this amazing Gospel of Luke so we could get fired up about Jesus Christ. Listen, I've been pretty fired up about Jesus Christ for a long time now, but now having studied Luke in depth for a while now, like, I'm super fired up about Jesus. I don't know about you guys, but I'm getting more and more fired up about Jesus every single day that I get into the book. I love him. He's awesome. He's worthy. I have to praise him more. I want to serve him more. I want to give him more. And when I think about the cross always commands more of me. Never enough. He commands the same of all of us. He commands more. If you're advanced in your relationship with him, not enough. More. He wants more. And I'm getting pretty fired. Is anyone else fired up about Jesus? I know Mike's fired up about Jesus. I was wondering about the rest of y'all, if you're fired up about Jesus. Because I'm fired up about Jesus. I'm super fired up about Jesus, and I want to take a little hiatus from the Gospel of Luke because it's Christmas surprise, and so I want to take about 3 weeks, and I want to preach some different stuff that God put in my heart. I'm there in the Scriptures. He's leading me in a different place. So for 3 weeks, we're going to talk a little Christmassy, and so this week and next week we'll talk some Christmas, and then what's really really weird is that on Christmas Eve, I have no idea what I'm going to preach about yet. Like, he hasn't given me that one yet. He's kind of funny about that. Okay, so I don't even know what's going to happen, but I'm thinking it's probably Christmas on Christmas, but I don't know. But I know for these 2 weeks, we're going to take a little hiatus from the Gospel of Luke, but by no means are we going to take a hiatus from gathering truth. Okay, that's what we need to do. So these next couple weeks, you know, it's Christmas and we got the gift giving season and everyone's all fired up about Christmas and Santa Claus and Black Friday came, right? Black Friday came and that night I was at the gas station by my house, right? And it was, I mean, I'm still digesting my turkey, and there's this truck pulls up at the gas station, and it's got these televisions in the bed in boxes that the size of this front pew, like just massive, just unbelievable. I don't even know what they cost, but I know I couldn't buy it. But they were huge. People buying stuff like crazy, right? Buying stuff like crazy. It's the gift giving season, and I understand we get some good gifts. Who would like some good gifts for Christmas? I'd like some good gifts for Christmas. How many people would like to give some good gifts for Christmas? I'd like to give some good people give good. I've gotten some good gifts over the years. I've given some good gifts over the years as well. Okay, but let's just start here. Okay, tonight let's start here. The Bible tells us in James 1:17 that every good and perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father. So all these awesome gifts that you've gotten or given, like any, let me get in a little info. Any bit of generosity that a Christian shows, it's not them that's doing it. And I can speak from experience, and this might not be what you want to hear from your pastor, but I'm not nice, I'm not generous, I don't have a lot of money to give up to y'all, and I don't want to do anything for anybody because I can barely take care of myself. So anytime I do something good for you, it's God-inspired, trust me. I'm just being honest. The rest of you might not say it, but I will. I'm American, man. I want mine. And I don't want to take what little I have and give it to you. Get your own. I mean, that's just our nature. Come on now in church, let's be honest. That's what we are. Some of us are a little more generous than others, but generally speaking, we'll probably buy a little bit more stuff for ourselves than our neighbors. Like we look at your house, right? Your house is filled with your stuff, right? Is your neighbor's house filled with more of your stuff than your house? No. Because you buy stuff for yourself. So to be generous to others, it's not in our nature really to want to do that. But the Bible is very clear. Every good and perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father. So here's the title of the message that we got this week. And I want you to repeat it with me. Okay? Can you put it up there for a second? That's it right there. Repeat this with me. Black Friday. Black Friday. No, that's no good. Come on now. Black Friday, ain't got nothing on this. That's right. Black Friday ain't got nothing on what God does. Every good and perfect gift comes from above and comes down from the Father. So we're going to spend 2 weeks talking about gifts from God. And so since we're going to use the word gift a ton, I want you to shout it to me later too. There's going to be some times you get some chances to shout in church. Who grew up in a church where you weren't allowed to talk when you were little? Yeah. We're going to forget that right up in here right now. Okay. We're done with that foolishness. Your mommy ain't here. And my mommy's Jewish. She don't even want me here. She's not on Facebook. Praise the Lord. So here's the definition of gift. If you take notes, which I love, you jot this down. Anything given willingly without the expectation of payment. Anything given willingly without the expectation of payment. It's a grace. And oftentimes in the Scriptures, if you do some studying at all, you'll see that grace and gift is sometimes interchanged. It's a grace. It's something that God just does, right? And so this speaks of God's nature. and his predisposition. This just who he is. It's a predisposition. It's what he's already decided to be and do before you do anything, good or bad. It's in his nature to want to say yes and give. It's who he is. And when we get our brains wrapped around that, then we can start to worship him well because we know who he is, right? And that's exactly God's default attitude. His answer is generally yes. See, a lot of times you might think, well, his answer is not yes. I've been praying for something for a long time. It's always been no, 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 no. Well, maybe you're not praying for something that's going to be good for you. I shared with my brother Brian today that I thought I was going to have a certain job many years ago, and I wanted it so bad, and I was so qualified for this job. Like, there was no one in the country that was more qualified than me. I could just tell you that in all sincerity. Like, I'm not bragging. It's true. But somehow I never got that job. I never got that job because I think in God's infinite wisdom, he could understand that with my massive drinking problem and all my other addictions, that going from no money to making over $200,000 a year in 1 week would probably be an issue for me. I'd be dead. And I'm just thinking that maybe he kind of thought that one day he'd have that stubborn, rebellious, addicted Jew boy up here preaching his word. Maybe. And so that's why I didn't get the job, but I wanted it, man. And so sometimes we pray we don't get it, but his default is yes. And that's why when the Jewish leaders that were the Roman centurion that the Roman centurion sent to Jesus, remember we talked about him a couple weeks ago? When he sent those people, those Jewish elders to Jesus, it said that they begged Jesus to come. They didn't need to. Did he respond to that? Any of you here? No, he didn't respond to that. He didn't respond to that at all. He doesn't need to be begged. It's in God's nature to bless. That is what he wants to do. Okay, so in a moment of absolute clarity, if you're unsure as to what God's nature is, you can see it illustrated perfect clarity in Matthew 7:11. And I would love if you would turn your attention to that verse. Okay, and I'm just going to say, while you're turning there, I'm going to just give you a warning that I will not be short tonight, and I am not going to apologize for it. God has laid lots on my heart. I'm going to share it with you. If you have to leave, that's totally cool. You can. You won't offend or hurt anybody's feelings. I just know that God has impressed upon me a golden corral of food here tonight. And so I want to share it with you, and I hope that at this point in the life of our church, as we've gathered, that we're starting to be that kind of people that doesn't want to shy away and run off to Golden Corral because Golden Corral is in here and that you want that. You know what I'm saying? Like, hey, preacher, give me some more. I like hearing that once in a while. So I just want to say that in advance. So Matthew 7:11 is quite clear. It speaks of God's nature. It speaks of his predisposition. It says that, and I mentioned a minute ago, if you sinful people can give good gifts, right? And that's, we're, none of us are perfect, right? We make some mistakes along the way, don't we? Yeah. Right, right? And we talked about Christmas gifts and getting good gifts and giving good gifts and the 27,000-inch TVs that are in the guy's truck and all those cool things, right? So if you sinful people right here can give good gifts, right? How much more so will your heavenly Father give good gifts, I can't reach that high, to those who ask? That's just in his nature to want to give awesome gifts. And the only part of that that you're involved in is this. Lord, I'm open to receive that which you already want to give me. Like this. See, when you're kind of worshiping and your hands are up, like, it's not magic or something crazy like that, but it kind of sends a signal to the Lord, like, Lord, I'm not just worshiping you, but I'm also doing this. Like, I'm ready, man. I'm ready to hear your voice. I'm ready to receive from you all that you would already want to give me. Lord, what is it that you are willing to gift me? That's a good place to be. And so I just jotted down six things that are actually gifts from God. So I did a study this past week on the gifts of God. I'm not talking about things that I had to like go to a commentary or get like different translations and what does this guy think? What does this really mean? And discern. No, these are directly in the scriptures that say this is a gift of God. Like I didn't have to make anything up. I didn't have to be creative. Praise the Lord. So it's in there. Okay, so that's what we want to do. We want to go through these six things. So kind of just I'm gonna fire them at you, and I'm gonna explain them, and I'm gonna use the Bible to do so. If that'd be cool. Okay, so here's the first one. Do me a favor and turn to Ecclesiastes. The page number and the reference right there on the screen. Ecclesiastes 5:19. All right, Ecclesiastes 5:19. This is a smart guy, Solomon. He wrote some things. And I want you to go there. I want you to see. Here's the first. Well, it's actually, I shouldn't say six things. It's 6 points, and some of them have several things. All right? So if you're there, get your eyes on God's word. Everyone got Bibles open? I like it. It's good. Huh? Can't see? Here, do me a favor. I know he's decided against this, but because Pops is so awesome, and he decided to come having quadruple bypass surgery, let's pop on those fluorescents for Pops so he can read his Bible. All right? That'd be awesome. We'll put on some lights for you, Pops, okay? I love you. Don't be surprised to see him up here one day. I'm saying, right? I'm prophesying right here. Come on. All right, you ready? There we go. You see it now, Pops? Is that better?
Yeah.
All right. Ecclesiastes 5:19. You ready? It is a good thing to receive wealth from God and the good health to enjoy it, to enjoy your work and accept your lot in life. Here it is. Ready? This is indeed a gift from God. So I didn't make anything up, right? He just listed 3 things right there that God gives that are a gift. And I love this verse. I love this verse, but I'm quite sure that most of the population would not love this verse. And I'll tell you why. Because in our world here, you all know, we praise the self-made man. And we praise the self-made woman. We love to praise people who went from nothing and worked really hard and they earned this and they put themselves in position to do that and they earned this degree and they work really hard and they created this company and they did this. And whether you're a Clinton person or a Trump person, one of the things that people praise him about is that he was a self-made guy. He didn't need anybody to help him. He made it all on his own. And so people praised him for that. I'm not ragging the guy at all. I mean, he's a cool dude and everything. But this here says that all that stuff, yeah, that's not from you, dude.
That's right.
You really didn't earn anything, right? It flies in the face of our culture. It's completely countercultural. All these things, if you have any of it, is all from the Lord. And is it too much to say that's true? Is it too much to believe that wealth and health and a job and enjoying it, and really your lot in life is a summary term, that just means everything. What you have, where you are, your relationships, your influence, how much money you have, all that stuff, your house, your car, everything that makes up who you are in your life, that's your lot in life. And it says here that all that is a gift from God. Is it too high of a statement to say that that's really God that did that? When you take into account Acts 17:26 says that God created all the nations of the earth, that he decides when they will rise and when they will fall, and that he determined the boundaries of every nation. He's the one who decided when Rome will rise and fall. He decided when Egypt would rise and fall. He decided when Babylon would rise and fall. He's the one who decided when Russia, the Soviet Union, would rise and fall. He's the one who decided when the wall comes down. He's the one who decided when our country started and when and if it ends. It's on the Lord, not us.
Amen.
He's in charge. And so if he's in charge of all that, is it too much to say that he's in charge of your personal stuff? I mean, when you look at the map of America and you see all that squiggly line, Jesus, You see that boot in Italy? Jesus, he decided all that. So is it too much to ask to say that he decided how much you make for a living? Or where your house is? Or how much influence you have on people? Or where you're going to live? Or what you're going to do for a job? Or whether you're going to like it or not? I know people that talk about health. Look, I'm not saying you should or shouldn't, but I know people that they spend their whole life, you know, they're juicing and eating broccoli and stuff, and they croak at 40. And then there's all the little crotchety ladies, they're sucking down two packs of cowboy killers a day, and they live till they're 90. I'm not saying you should take up smoking, man. I'm just saying that you could do whatever you want, but I ain't eating a bunch of broccoli and juicing. You can have that. I'm having steak. And when my time comes, according to this, he's telling me that the health to enjoy even what I'm doing right now is a gift from God. Amen. It doesn't matter how much. I love when you guys like clap and amen and all this kind of stuff. That's all good, right? But the fact that I could even enjoy this, you could clap and applaud and say, preach, you're the best pastor in the world. It wouldn't mean anything unless God lit my heart up to say, hey, this is actually pretty cool. I know preachers that have awesome big churches with thousands of people, and they're miserable, right? They're miserable. And they're getting all this praise and everything. It's of the Lord. So what happens is that we start to focus on the self-made man. Look what I did. Look what I worked and earned and created and made. And look at me. Look at what I've done. That's false worship. And so the Bible tells us in Romans 12:3, don't think you are better than you really are. Be honest in your evaluation of yourself, measuring yourself by the faith God has given. It's not anything you did. You ain't that cool. You're not that smart. You're not that bright. You're not that resourced. Everything is from him. So when we start to shift this, so any wealth and health and an awesome job and anything in my life, I got a great family, great house, great car, great this, great that, great that, anything like that. When I start praising myself for that, that's false. It's the gift giver who gave it to you. That's who you should be praising. But sometimes people don't just do that and look at themselves and go, look at me. They look at the actual stuff that they got and start praising that stuff. Like, man, not only am I awesome, but look at the awesome house I live in. And we start praising that stuff. And the Bible's clear about that too. Get your eyes off those gifts and start paying attention to the gift giver. Psalm 62:10, if riches increase, do not set your heart upon them. Don't be, you can look at them and go, hey, thank you, Lord, but don't be setting your heart on those things. Like, oh man, this is what identifies me. This is why I'm awesome, because I have X amount of dollars in the bank, and I have X amount of houses that I own, and I have beautiful cars and this and that. Don't set your heart upon those things. They really don't matter. We need to get our focus back on the one who gifted us these things rather than the one who thought he earned them or created them or made them or the stuff itself. Both of them are idolatry, and God does not share his glory. And so my lot in life is a gift from above. It's not earned. It's not deserved. You're not entitled to it in any way. And it's not something that I did. Amen? That's the first gift from God. Here's the second one. You're going to find it in John chapter 4, verse 10. You going there? Here's some pages. John 4, 10. So while you're turning there, there's this story, and a lot of you know it. Jesus is... He goes to this well, and he's a Jewish man, okay? So back then, women were viewed differently than men. They were kind of lower in society, right? So men didn't generally hang out or talk to women. And then Jewish folks, they were the chosen people, and so they felt like they were up here, and all the rest of you guys were down here, right? And I say that because I'm Jewish. That was the environment I grew up in. Like, I repent for my family, but my family looked down on you because we were the chosen people and you're not. So Jesus, being Jewish, he wouldn't talk to and associate with non-Jews, and he certainly, being a man, wouldn't hang out with women. So here's Jesus at this well, and he goes up to this woman and he's talking to her about a drink of water at the well. So in John 4:10, 4:9, she asked him, like, what, you know, what are you talking to me about this drink for? Like, you're a Jew and I'm a Samaritan, and, you know, like, why is this even happening? And Jesus says this: if you only knew the gift God has for you and who you are speaking to, like, can you imagine? Yeah, I'm God. You would ask me, and I would give you, here's the gift, living water. What in the world is that, you say?
What is that?
Yeah. Well, if you study the scriptures, and we talk about studying the scriptures in here often, I always tell you to study the scriptures. Don't just read them, right? Don't just memorize them. Study them. Know what it's talking about. Well, if you did a little study in the scriptures, you'll find out that the living water is the thing that gets put inside of you when you say yes, and the thing that's put inside of you when you said yes is the Holy Spirit, okay? It's the Holy Spirit that's leading you in truth, convicting you of sin, and comforting you in trials. Now, Acts 2:38, Acts 8:20, Acts 10:45, and Acts 11:17 with absolute clarity say that God gives us the gift of the Holy Spirit. Okay? He is the same Spirit that raised Christ from the dead that now lives in the believer. He's the Spirit that renews your thoughts and attitudes. Ephesians 4:23. He's God's down payment to the believer that ensures a full salvation in heaven. Ephesians 1:14. He's the one that inspired all of Scripture, 2 Peter 1:21. He's the third person of the Trinity. He's the Holy Spirit that God gifts you when you believe in Jesus Christ, Ephesians 1:13. And if you choose, say choose, if you choose to be led by this Holy Spirit, He will produce these things in your life. Love, joy, peace, patience. I got to pause there for. I thought that was pretty good. Kindness, you know, they need to be kind to me. Goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. If you choose to obey the leading of this Spirit that is now in you, these things will increase in your life. So as I read the list, I'm going to read the list again. I didn't know I was going to do this, but I'm going to read the list again. And identify, let Him speak to you. Let Him tell you which one on the list you need, which one you're struggling with. You ready? Sorry about this, but I know you're going to hate me, but be kind, it said. Where's your deficit? You ready? Love? I love you. You're right, but it's too much to work on. So I just want to offer you this. Just go with one. Pick one, okay? Whatever one He puts in your heart, He pricks your heart in the one, pick it. Jot it down. That's the thing, okay? That's the thing. Love, joy, okay? Peace, patience. That usually gets something. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness. Gentle? The gentleness? And self-control. Here's the awesome thing about it. According to the scriptures, you need only ask and you will receive. The Bible does say in another part, one of the other gospels, it says, if you, those who are sinners, can give good gifts, how much more so will your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask? So if you're lacking, if you have a deficit in the love department, if you have a deficit in the kindness or the, what was it, gentleness, or joy, you need only ask because it's in His nature to want to give that to you, right? So open up your hand and receive. It's that simple. It's that simple. Okay, so here's the third one. You writing these things down, I hope. Go to Romans 5:15. Romans 5:15. Pursuing truth, right? Just amping up. Want to amp up the spirit. The more you know, the more you grow. I like that. That was good. Right there. Okay, Romans 5, 15. You there?
Yes.
So we're talking here. God's talking to us about this whole Adam and Eve thing. That was a wreck, right? Train wreck. And they sinned and it messed us all up. But then all of a sudden Jesus comes along and he's going to kind of fix some things, right? So look in Romans 5, 15. There's this great difference, it says, between Adam's sin and God's gracious what?
Gift.
Oh, there's that word again. For the one sin of the sin of Adam, that brought death. That was, say, bad. But even greater than that, right, is God's wonderful grace and his what?
Gift.
His gift of forgiveness to many through this other man, Jesus Christ. There's the gifting. A result of God's gracious gift is very different than the one man's sin. Adam's sin led to condemnation. Boo, bad, right? You ready? You guys ready? But God's free gift leads to our being made right with God, even though we are guilty of many sins. Don't look at anybody. Sin of this one man caused death. You ready? But even greater is God's wonderful grace and his of righteousness. So I said there were six things, but there's three of them there. There's forgiveness and being made right with God and his righteousness. And notice these things, that none of them are something that you did. Like you didn't get your record kind of ignored, like you sinned. We sinned. All of us sinned, right? And he didn't say you're innocent, really. He just pardoned you. You did it. You can't turn back time, right? but he pardoned you of the sin that you did commit, right? Do you understand that? Like, you didn't earn it or have it wiped away. He pardoned you. Forgiveness, someone has to give you forgiveness, right? So he gave you the forgiveness, and it said that you were made right with God. You didn't make yourself right with God. He made you right with him. See, he did the work. And it's not your righteousness, because I don't know about anyone in here, but I'm not righteous. You're not righteous. Nobody is perfect, right? Watch this. Do me a favor. Go to Psalm 15 for a second. I want you to read something, okay? I want you to read something. And we're talking about your righteousness and how good you are and all this kind of stuff. This will take the knees out, take the legs out of anyone who thinks, well, I'm a good person, right? Out the window. Out the window. You ready? Psalm 15. You there? I'm so anxious to read this, I can't stand it. Okay. Here's a question. Who may worship in your sanctuary, Lord? Who may enter your presence on your holy hill? Those who lead blameless lives and do what is right. I don't know about you, but when I read that and you read that to you just now, like, did you feel your legs get just knocked out from underneath you? You know what I mean? Everyone. It's like a universal, unilateral eraser. No one pulls it off. No one. Some of us have better days than others. Some of you are better off than others, like in your behavior and your morality. I get it. Some of us are just wretched. Some of us are not so bad. But nobody pulls this off. What does it say? The only ones who can come into the presence of God and worship him on his hill to get where you're at, Lord, you have to lead blameless lives. That means you can't be guilty of anything. So we're screwed, right? What are you gonna do? What will you do? So if blameless is the prerequisite of worshiping God and having this relationship with him, what is blameless? That's perfection. So if perfection is the prerequisite of a right relationship with God, being made right with God, is you got to be perfect, then his holy hill ain't no hill at all. It's Everest. How in the heck are we going to get up there? You can't. So for Christmas this year, I wrote God a Christmas letter, like little kids do to Santa. And he decided to go to Gander Mountain and buy you some hiking gear so you could get up Mount Everest. You ready for it? Okay, turn to Colossians chapter 1. All the hiking gear you need. Right here. Truth. We're gaining truth. We're catching up to it. We're gaining on it. Colossians chapter 1, verse 21. Right? So you put yourself in the psalm. Picture the holy hill, Everest, right? And there's God up there, perfect and high and lifted up and alone and holy, right? Perfect. And we're down here at base camp. Pretty far away, weren't we? Yeah. He's up there, isn't he? We're all the way down here. So look what it says. You were once far away from God. Duh. You were his enemies, separated from him. Remember, he's up there, you're down here, right? Why? Because of your evil thoughts and actions. That's just Psalm 15 again. You weren't blameless. That's why. You weren't blameless, so he's up there and you're down here. Yet now, he, not you, you didn't do anything. He has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence. He took you up the hill. And you are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. He brought you up the holy hill into his very presence. Now talk about something given willingly without expectation of payment. You can't earn that. You can't expect that. You don't deserve that. You're not entitled to that. He reached down from the summit of the mountain and dragged you up there by the cross of Christ. That's what he did, right? That's what he did. 2 Corinthians 5:21, God, this is awesome. God made Christ, who knew no sin, who was blameless, not just your sin offering to pay for your sin. The scriptures teach us that God, who took Jesus, who was blameless, and made him sin, that you might be the righteousness of God in him. He made the blameless one all blame, and then God himself took nails and killed sin on the cross. That's what he did. So sin is dead. Listen to me, loved ones. Sin is dead in your life. And the only time it lives is when you try to be God and breathe life into it. And you need to stop. And I need to stop preaching to myself now. I need to stop, okay? Sin is dead. Now, as a result of this, it even gets better. How could it get better than that? But it does, because God is good. And he's a giver of good gifts. So do yourself a favor and go to Hebrew chapter 10. You Hebrew, you crazy Hebrew. Hebrews chapter 10. Now, so as a result of what he's done, now listen, this is what happens. This is the fleshing out. This is you getting to enjoy this gift. Watch this now. He has brought you into his presence, holy, blameless, and without single fault. Now, do you? That's positional. Do you have a fault in your life? Say yes, I do. Many, right? Many. But Jesus has none. And so this is this doctrine of imputed righteousness. You go to the cross, give him junk and death, and he gives you his perfection. Did you still do bad stuff? Yes, but when God sees you, he sees his blameless son. Right? So I heard someone say, let me see if I get this right. Someone said, this Jesus, who is a son, oh, help me, Lord. He He's a son who becomes a slave so those of us that are slaves can become a son. Awesome, right? That's awesome. I didn't get, that's not mine, so praise God. Praise God. So Hebrews 10:19 says this. And so, dear brothers and sisters, that's you, we can boldly enter heaven's most holy place because of the blood of Jesus. By his death, not yours, nothing you did. By his death, Jesus opened a new and life-giving way through the curtain into the most holy place. And since we have a great high priest, Jesus Christ, who rules over God's house, let us go right into the presence of God with sincere hearts, fully trusting him. For our guilty consciences, see what I'm saying? Like, we have done stuff. We've done stuff. You've done stuff. I've done stuff, right? So you walk in with a guilty conscience. You know you've done wrong. But for our guilty consciences have been sprinkled with Christ's blood to make us clean. And our bodies have been washed with pure water. So no excuse for doing bad. But just know that the work of Christ on the cross has made you holy, blameless, and without fault in the presence of God Almighty on the Everest of holiness. That's where he is. Okay? Jesus imputes this righteousness to you so you can start hiking. All right, here's the next one, just coming right at you. This one has two parts. It's the gift of salvation. And kind of the same, but eternal life, okay? Romans 6:23 says that the wages of sin is death. Does that need explanation? We understand that when someone, we put on the news and someone does something bad, they deserve to be punished, right? We know this. They deserve to be put away. And we know that as parents, we understand that when a child does something bad, we know that there's to be punished. Like that, something bad deserves something bad. That's just the way it happens, right? You get punished. And so we understand by the scriptures, and we also understand by real life and experience that the wages, the payment, what you deserve for your sin is death. You deserve to be punished. Do we all understand that? But the verse is only halfway done. But the free, let's try it again. But the free of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus the Lord. Ephesians 2:8 says, God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It is a from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we have done, so no one can boast about it. This is the heart of the Roman centurion again, where he understands that his position and his power and the prestige of Rome and the ability to just kill on command if he wanted to, and he oversaw soldiers, and he was a powerful man in his culture. But even that, he said, Jesus, I'm not even worthy to be in your presence. I'm not worthy to have you come to my house, my opulent, wealthy house that everyone would praise and everyone would want to come there. I'm not even worthy to have you in my house. That's what we're talking about. That's salvation. I'm not worthy of it. I can't earn it. I don't deserve it. I'm not entitled to it. But by God's grace, you gave it to me. And I can't boast about anything that I've done, much like Ecclesiastes 5:19, wealth and health and enjoying work and your lot in life. Everything that is you are a gift that usurps all credit from yourself or usurps credit from the stuff or the world that you think you got it from, and it shifts it to the gift giver, Almighty God. It's the same thing here with salvation. I can't earn it. I don't deserve it. I'm not entitled to it. It's a gift from God. And so if you have bent the knee to Jesus, if you have given up your will for his, and that's an awesome thing. And in our world, that's not a promoted thing. To give up your will and become like a slave of someone else on your own free will, that's not popular, man. But if you've done that, praise God, he has finally busted you enough to realize that that's a good thing. So praise God for that gift. Praise God for that gift. And let me tell you something. That right there, that's the gospel. That's the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. That no one on God's green earth deserves glory. No one. Every single person has broken some command. I don't care how good you are. I don't care how many old ladies you hold the door for. I don't care how much you give to the Red Cross and sponsor little starving babies from Africa and all these things. It doesn't make any difference. At some point in your life, you did something. Everyone. And God created you to be perfect like him. And you didn't. You messed it up. And so did I. But by God's grace, he loves this creation so much. He's like, man, they really screwed this up. I'll help them. So that's the good news. You don't earn it. You don't deserve it. You ain't entitled to it, but he gives it. Amen. Praise the Lord. That's it. And so if you want to be saved, you want to have that relationship with God, you just got to acknowledge that that's the truth. Just say, I'm a mess up. I can't do this without you, Lord. Just help me. Save me. I'm nothing. I'm like the centurion. I'm the soldier. I thought I had some stuff, but all of it's nothing. It's not going to get me anywhere. I'm having all this stuff in hell forever. Like, that, what good is that going to do me? What is it if a man has everything, gives up his soul? Worthless. So that's the gospel. It's a scandal because it's too stinking easy, isn't it? We got to earn everything in this world. No one's walking around. Publisher's Clearinghouse says, yet to come to my house. You know what I mean? But my father's house did. That's even better. Here's the fifth one. Go to 1 Corinthians chapter 1. There's too many of them there, and I just can't give you a title. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. You turning? Heard more pages before. Hi, Hannah. Hi, Troy. No. Yeah, Troy, yeah, you're at work. Wait a minute, you're at work. You're not supposed to be watching. But pay attention. Love you. Wait a minute now. Where's that other boy of yours? I'll knock him out. Did he leave? I will knock him out. I need to do that, don't I? Permission from his mama. Let's get him. Round up the posse. Come on, guys. Oh, man, he makes me so mad. Knock him out. Ooh. Nick, you know what he needs. Crumble right in his chest. Yeah, buddy. All right. So, all right. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. Look in verse 4. Here's Paul. Loves these people, right? I love you. I always thank my God for you and for the gracious, what? Yeah. So it's more than one, man. I should have put a Christmas tree up here and start stuffing them under there. Gracious gifts he has given you. Now that you, he's talking to a group of people here, right? He says, the gracious gifts he has given you now that you belong to Christ Jesus. Through him, God has enriched your church in every way with all of your eloquent words and all of your knowledge. This confirms that what I told you about Christ is true. Now you have every spiritual you need as you eagerly wait for the return of our Lord Jesus Christ. So you see here, it there's a little bit of a shift here in what I'm teaching you here is that it's not just how he pours out his blessings, his gifts on you individually. Now he's talking about corporately as a church. So it shifts a little bit to this collective church gifting. And yet, it's very much the same as the personal gifting in that all credit for this. Here's a church that's a good church, he's saying. Like, there's some things going on there that are good. So there's some eloquent words. So there's people that understand. He says eloquent words and knowledge. So they understand God and they're preaching with some clarity, right? They understand stuff. So there's some health in that church. But just like the individual gifts of health and wealth and lot in life and forgiveness and all those things individually, corporately, if a church is good or awesome in any way, that too is not credit to the people in it, but to the God who started it. Okay, all gifting is from God, not the people. And so if the church is healthy and effective in any tangible, measurable way, And if the people leading it are I'll just quote, good in any way at what they're doing at all, that too is a gift from God. And churches that have, you know, we say, oh, you got an awesome pastor over there, and they got an awesome worship band over there, and all that kind of stuff. Okay, yeah, but praise doesn't go to that guy or that group. The praise always must shift to the gift giver of the awesome pastor or the awesome worship team. You see what I'm saying? So that's what we have to do. So here, Ephesians chapter, just look. Do me a favor. Look in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. And this is a little uncomfortable because I'm your pastor, but I'm just going to be faithful to the text. I'm not going to shy away from stuff, okay, even though it's a little bit uncomfortable. So Ephesians 4:11, I'm trying to support a claim here that gifts come from God. So anything that's awesome about the church, it's not the person, but it's the Lord that's awesome, right? Now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church. That's you guys, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Their responsibility is to equip God's people to do his work and to build up the church, the body of Christ. So these leaders are a gift to shepherd your soul, to be truth proclaimers, and so that you can amp up your spirit worship and reach your full potential in the Lord. That's our job as leaders. So if it's healthy at all, if it's dynamic, if your church is dynamic at all, if it's far-reaching at all, if it's effective in any way, shape, or form, if the sermons have any clarity, and if the sermons inspire in any way, no praise goes to the pastor. All praise goes to Jesus, who gifted the church with that man of God to inspire you to do the work of God. That's the way it has to be. He's the pastor. He's the pastor. Everything is from him. And so you can see their job is just, they're just servants doing their duty, man. That's all I am. I'm a servant doing my duty. This is what I'm supposed to do. I'm just thankful that you guys even come. So I have someone to talk to. It would stink if the place was empty. So I'm just thankful, but I'm just an unworthy servant doing my duty. That's it. He loves me. And I love him, and I'm psyched up about doing this stuff. I'm getting fired up again right here, right now. So here's the thing. So and I love it when people hear the word of God and it changes their life and they start to change and they're equipped to do the work and the work starts happening. It's starting to happen around here, you know? And people are starting to do things. It's not just me doing it anymore. It's not just me and Mary. It's not just me and Meredith. There's people doing some things over here now. And that excites me, right? That excites me. So something's going on here, something, right? And I'm happy about that. So we're to be equipped by the leaders. We're to be inspired by the message. By the worship. Right? That's what we're supposed to do. Why? Next gift. Last gift. Ephesians 3:7. Ephesians 3:7. So if the church is good in any way, it's the gift giver that caused that to happen. If the people that are leading it are any good at all at what they're doing, that's a gift also. And they're there to just get you ready to do some work. In Ephesians 3:7, here's Paul. And what does it say here? I don't like this translation, but on this one anyway. By God's grace and mighty power, I have been given, this one says the privilege, say weak. Yeah, it's the gift. You read another Bible. By God's grace and mighty power, I've been given the gift of serving him by spreading this good news. Serving the church is a gift. From God. It's a gift from God. He said, I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace. Now that's a good translation right there. I'm going to read it again. I became a servant of this gospel by the gift of God's grace. And I see some evidence around here, man. I see some evidence that make me believe that 2017 is going to be the best year that this church has ever had. I see some evidence here that this church is in 2017 that more people are going to hear and receive the good news of Jesus Christ than ever before. I believe 2017 is going to be the wettest year that this church has ever had. I do. I believe it. And I also believe that right now, as God's word is being proclaimed to you, that His Spirit is working on your heart right now in the area of serving. I believe it. I believe with every bit of my heart that He's speaking to you about the privilege, the gift of serving. I believe that if we get this truth, that serving is a gift rather than something you don't want to do, and leaders at churches, and I know a lot of them, have to beg you to do. No more. I believe that He will work on you right now. If you will open up your heart to the truth of God's word, Paul the Apostle said is a gift of God's grace to become a servant of the gospel. Let Him work on you, man. Open up. Open up. And I think that if this truth really buries down into your heart and you let Him change the way you think from a burden to a gift, then our church will be healthy, growing, and full of love. I believe it with all my heart. And that is a sudden and momentous shift in the status quo. That's a revolution. Because you know it's true. Listen, if you have been in church at all, or if you know pastors of churches, you know that no matter where you go, that 10% of the work is done, I'm sorry, 100% of the work is done by 10% of the church. You know this. You know it. Even if you're stubborn and you're rebellious and you haven't chosen to serve, you know that when you come here every week that these Bibles are on the table and they're nice and neat and there's toilet paper in the bathroom. You know that it's there. And you know you didn't do it. But you know that it's there. So you know that 100% of this little show that we got going on here is done by someone and it's not you. You know it. But let me just challenge you. What if all of a sudden you stepped in and it wasn't 10% of you doing it? What if it was 20, 30, 40%, 50% of you serving diligently? Do you know that 10% of the people do 100% of the work, and every year in America for the last 20, 4,000 churches a year close? Now, something's wrong, man. Something's wrong. But can you imagine if we stepped in and changed the way we thought about serving? And we realized that it was a gift, not a burden. How awesome would that be? And listen, I'm going to tell you something. To worship in spirit and in truth has to include serving. It has to. It has to include serving. You can't pick and choose. Bless you. The reason why this is revolutionary, that we would step in and see an increase in the percentage of people getting it and serving in the church rather than consuming in the church, is that it just goes against our sinful bent. Like I said earlier, I'm not going to the store. Like, we went to the store last night to go food shopping at Walmart. I just got to tell you that when we went, we didn't go there and spend our time and money to stock your fridge. But right? I mean, isn't it true? How many people went shopping this week for food? Raise your hand. Okay, how many of you went shopping to fill my fridge? It's just not what we do. So it's just not in our nature to want to serve like this. We want to be served. And once in a while, we'll throw each other a bone, you know, but that's not in our nature to do that. And that's why God is preaching so hard against it. That's why I'm preaching so hard against it. They don't want to serve. And that's why churches are begging people to serve instead of them willingly serving. God's word is true, and I believe that it is, and serving is truly a gift and not a burden. What would it be like if people, like you've been coming here for a while, most of you, right? What would happen if when they came to this church, I'm just throwing this out there, they came to this church, and as they drove down 441 and they approached the property, someone was standing out there, this is silly, but with a sign, spinning a sign like they do at
Papa John's, which they'll do for $8 an hour. What would happen if someone said, you know what? I want our community to know that we love them and want them here. And so you just said, you know what, preacher, I want to stand out there with a sign. I just want to wave. When people are driving by or coming into Home Depot, I just want to smile and say hi with a revolution sign. Let them know that they're loved and wanted. And then when they came in and they got to their parking space, someone was out there, not in their face being annoying, but close to their car. And as they opened the car, you just said, thanks for coming, man. It's good to see you. And then they got to the door, and these guys are back there, and she's just smiling because that's just what she does. She can't help but smile. I bet you if I look over there, she's smiling. Yeah, see? But see what I'm saying? Like, isn't that so not normal? And they came in, and people were just greeting them and welcoming them and shaking their hand and saying, we're glad you're here, and this food prepared, and someone's making coffee. Can I get you something? Oh, you've got kids. Let me bring you back here and meet Mimi. She's so nice, and she's got these great classrooms. And oh, and by the way, they went to the classrooms, and there was people lined up to serve in the children's ministry, to teach the kids about Jesus, instead of, I'm just saying, my wife back there every week for the last 3 years. I'm just a shameless plug for my dear sweet wife. It would be nice to have her up in here one day. But we don't serve. But you know that when you get here, someone's that sweet girl is going to watch your kids. So I'm just telling you the truth. I mean, it's a house of truth, right? We're friends. I'm not, am I offending anybody? No. You're used to it by now, right? So, but it's true, right? We all know we come here and the coffee's going to be, but what happens if the place was just filled with servants, and they walked in and they experienced that. And the band, there's been months that we've knew musicians upon musicians, and they sat in the seat while Jessica was dying up here. Shame on them, man. Right? Come on. And we want to do things that are nice and creative. And so what happens if you come in? God, you know what? The first thing that God is in the scriptures is creator. So, and he made us in his likeness, so you're creative. So what if you volunteered and said, you know what, I want to serve. How can I help you redesign the stage and make it look awesome so when people come in, it just looks, hey, this place is awesome. I like it here. No redemptive value, but just awesome. I love awesome. You guys love awesome? I love awesome. So what if you just decided, you know what, I'm not going to come in and just consume anymore. I'm going to partner with the church, and I'm going to consider serving a gift from God, and I'm going to receive it, and I'm going to use it for his glory. What happens if a church was like that? Because I just don't see that too often. I saw it one time in my life when I went up to New Spring Church in South Carolina. That's where we get our children's curriculum. 20,000 people. Several locations. They have one that's just in a convention center. They don't even own the building. So they have like 6,000 people that show up there every Sunday, and they have to set it all up and break it all down. Insane, right? Everywhere you look, there was a New Spring lady with a smile and a New Spring man with a smile and his t-shirt greeting you and helping you and escorting you to this room, and how can we help you? We're so glad you're here. And I was like, overwhelmed, because some churches you've been there, it's fake, right? Right? You've seen it, like, you just want to, like, right? But these people were really, really, it seemed authentic. And they're giving away their curriculum for free. That's a servant. That's what they're doing. They're serving. And they told Mimi, if you need some books and help, remember that lady? Here's my phone number, the children's leader at this, thousands of people. Here we are, a church of like 30 at the time. She's like, here, have my number. Call me anytime. I want to help you guys. Awesome, right? Awesome. That's the kind of church we need to be right here. We need to be that church right here for these people. This community needs to see something absolutely awesome. Serving should mark who we are as a people. That should be a mark of who we are. And listen, people think Christians, they describe Christians in a lot of different ways, don't they? We can't talk about those here. A lot of cussing and stuff. Can't do that, right? That's so wrong. But yet it's so right, isn't it? Mm. So but instead of saying that we're this and this and this that are kind of ugly, what they should say is, well, they're Christians. That means they do as he does and go where he goes and think as he thinks and say as he says. That's who we should be. So I leave you with this, and I'm going to call the band up. Philippians 2:5, I'll read it to you. Are you listening? We do as he does. We go where he goes. We think as he thinks. We say as he says. Philippians 2:5, though Jesus was God, he didn't cling to that. Instead, he emptied himself and took the humble position of a servant. Christians, right? If you're a real Christian, you do as he does, right? Then you're a servant. And it's not a burden anymore, it's a blessing. Can you stand? Would it be okay? I think that I just want to honor God. I want you to stand, if you can, as we worship him. God gives good and perfect gifts. And in this Christmas season of gift giving, we need to be reminded of that over and over and over again. And these are gifts that have lasting value. These are not gifts that are going to end up at your yard sale a year from now, or thrown into the toy box with the other 7,000 Barbie dolls. These are high impact, lasting gifts of significance. And next week, when we examine the concept of regifting, you're gonna understand that not only are these gifts lasting and of high impact, but not only can they affect you, how many people have been affected by God's forgiveness? Raise your hand, right? Awesome, right? But the gifting that God gives you, not only does it affect you, but it can affect the world around you when regifted. See, we don't look at regifting as a good thing, but God loves regifting, right? And so we're going to examine that next week, okay? So let's pray, and if you would stand in worship. I'm thinking about these gifts now. Forgiveness. Here, close your eyes. So forgiveness, being made right with God and his righteousness, even though we're guilty of so many sins, pardoned. Guilty conscience, but conscience sprinkled by the blood of Christ, so you're clean. Only those that are blameless can do what we're doing right now, and none of us are. But because of Christ's death on the cross, he has brought you into his very presence, holy, blameless, and without a single fault. Awesome. Imagine these things under your Christmas tree. Merry Christmas, people. Merry Christmas. These are the gifts that you've been given by Almighty God. No kid... goes and buys the gift. Mom and dad love the kid and they just go buy him a gift, right? And isn't that the way God is for us? Like, we didn't deserve it. We didn't buy it. He did. He just gives us gifts. It's just who he is. So think about all those awesome gifts that he gave you. Don't think lightly about him anymore. You think when your pastor is saying these things to you right now, forgiveness, righteousness, being made right with God, eternity, salvation, health, wealth, anything you have in life, it's all from him. Just think about that. Isn't there a sense of seriousness just stirring up inside of you? Like, does it just change your perspective on church and praying and scripture and all these things? Just think about that. Serving. Lord, I can't thank you. My words. I can't thank you, like, on behalf of all these people. I can't even thank you for me. I think about my Everest of sin that I brought to your cross. That you willingly pardoned me. I don't know what to say, Lord. just ask, Lord, that you would stir something inside of us. I guess the thing is, Lord, to stir up this idea of serving, because in our serving, other people might come to know and receive the gifts that we've already got. It's the kind of church we want to be. But we can't be that church, Lord, unless you gift us like that. Would you do that? Thank you. We praise you in Jesus' name.